Firdaus Bandriwala joins us on this conversation. Mr. Bandriwala, thank you so much for joining us on Bloomberg, and apologies for keeping you waiting. Let me begin by asking you about your expectations from the budget this time around. We are seeing tepid growth in certain sectors that could have a direct impact on the steel sector as well. What would be your top three wish lists?
Well, before I give you the wish list, I think it's important to understand the situation in terms of the impact of GDP and on steel demand. Steel is a derived demand, and it's important that the economy picks up. So my first requirement from the budget is put in an environment and a policy that allows 6% growth minimum. Because when there's 6% growth in GDP, steel demand goes by a multiple of the GDP. But when the GDP drops to less than 6%, then steel demand growth is a fraction of the GDP. So I think that's a threshold level. And most of the demand for steel comes from infrastructure, over 62 to 64%. So second thing would be to put emphasis on the infrastructure sector so that it's good for the economy and it's good for the steel industry. And the third is to give us a level playing field. I think some of the FTA agreements that we have, where we have imports coming in from developed countries like Japan and South Korea at import duties of 2%, which is even lower than the import duty of iron ore, which is a contradiction in itself.
Mr. Bandriwala, you know, when we talk to corporates and over the last 1 year, we've seen several of them complain about project clearances, many projects being stuck. You've had, you know, if you look at pure data points, the investment cycle is pretty much grounded to a halt. And the problems are pretty much well known. What would you like the government to come out on the floor of the parliament and say that can, you know, set the ball rolling on getting the investments back on track, that can restore confidence in corporates like you to put fresh capex?
Two things. One is consistency in policy. You know, I think that's very important. The flip-flop of policy, once you start an investment and then you change the policy and the investment becomes a dud investment. I think that confidence in corporate India, that once a policy is announced, it's going to be consistent and it's not going to be retrospective. That's one. I know it's not a budget issue, but it's something that affects investments. And the second, I think, is perception and comfort and confidence that we are on the move, there is no policy paralysis, that things are going to take place, clearances are going to happen, nothing unfavorable or unfair, but it's equitable and it's fair and it's quick.
What is your own assessment of the demand supply situation, Mr. Bandriwala, right now? And do you see the ability of the industry as a whole ramping up production if we see some sort of the economy improving at least in the next 2-3 quarters?
I think the industry is well poised to meet the demand. Actually, for the first time after in a decade or so, India is going to be a net exporter of steel, because there is more capacity and more production in India today than there is demand, because demand has actually shrunk. Last year growth was hardly 1%. Today we have a capacity of 97 million tons. We are operating at a capacity utilization of 80%. And in the next year and a half, we will see additional capacity of 10 million tons. So I think in terms of capacity, there is capacity available here. It's important that the cost structure for the industry is not made unfavorable, so that when demand is there, the price is also at a level that is affordable for the downstream industries.
Let me get back to Mr. Bandriwala. Mr. Bandriwala, you're talking about some of the expectations from the metals, the steel sector. I want to ask you about the raw material availability. I remember, you know, talking to some of the steel companies perhaps 6-8 months ago, and many of them were of the view that we much rather look at securing our own raw material availability or needs overseas. What's the sense right now? Is raw material adequately available? What would you like the government to do?
You know, there is a perception that there is a shortage of iron ore because of the reduction in the exports of iron ore based on the Supreme Court ban on mining. So let's take a period of 5 years. 5 years ago, iron ore production, including fines, was in the region of about 135 million. It's gone. It is now 135 compared to 219. So there's been a drop. But all that drop that has taken place has actually taken place in exports. If you see the rise in production for steel, which has moved up in 5 years from 57 million to 78 million, and the consequent demand at 1.6 times, then I think there is capacity still available based on production, actual production, to meet the steel requirements. But I think there's a perception that the miners have sort of tried to create to increase prices. So we are in a very funny situation where internationally iron ore prices are dropping. In India, actually, iron ore prices are increasing. If you look at the value chain of the steel industry, 10 years ago, the value was downstream. Today, and it is expected in the short and medium term, that the value in the steel value chain will actually be upstream.
Sure.
And the profit margins are collected much earlier in the value chain. I think both from in terms of pricing and in terms of ensuring, one thing we want is either captive mining or assured contracts at a reasonable pricing formula. Today we are at the mercy of the large miners. They dictate the price and we have no options.
Mr. Bandriwala, we'll leave it there. Many thanks indeed for joining us with your perspective. Firdaus Bandriwala from SR Steel talking about some of the expectations of this sector from the budget and the demand, supply and price situation.